Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow List Show. Brilliant is offering a 30-day free trial and 20% off an annual premium subscription when you sign up at brilliant.org/scishow.
When you think of newer ways to generate electricity, maybe you think of renewable energy sources like solar or wind. But scientists can make the stuff from just about anything. And some of those ways of generating electricity are a lot weirder than putting turbines in a cornfield. Like, who would have thought that you could power an underwater camera with sound? Or charge up a Mars rover with warmth coming from the thing itself? Or run your electronics on plants? We're about to explore a few shocking new ways to make electricity. In 2022, MIT researchers made a prototype camera meant for underwater missions that uses sound to power itself. But before I can explain how it works, we need a quick lesson on the magic of piezoelectricity. The term has two root words, electric, obviously, and piezon, a Greek word that means to squeeze or to press. Put them together and you have electricity that comes from pressure. It refers to the electricity you get from some solid materials when you put pressure on them. Piezoelectric materials can be crystals, ceramics, or even biological materials like bone. But what they all have in common is deep within their crystal structure, the way their molecules are arranged. In most solid materials, molecules are arranged in rigid structures and are bonded to each other based on their electrical charges. Positive molecules bond with negative molecules, which bond with positive molecules, and so on. When non-piezoelectric materials are squeezed, the positive and negative ions within the structure come together evenly, so no electricity is formed. But piezoelectric materials have molecules that are arranged in a different way, because when they're squeezed, the positive and negative ions get kind of pushed out of place, forcing the electrons to move from one ion to another. And any movement of electrons creates electricity. We use this effect in many electronics, from quartz watches to smoke alarms, but we can also use piezoelectricity in more sophisticated devices. Which brings us back to those MIT researchers and their underwater camera. They wanted to see if they could use the ambient sound of the ocean to power the equipment. And remember, sound is just pressure waves moving through a medium. The prototype camera they built works because it's covered in piezoelectric transducers, a part that converts energy from one form to another. And they tested it using an artificial acoustic source. The sound waves apply pressure to the transducers, producing electricity. And then capacitors in the camera store the electricity so it only works when it has enough energy to do its job. The camera's imaging sensor uses very little power and can only capture grayscale images. But the team figured out how to capture color images by taking three pictures in a row with three different LED flashes, red, green, and blue, and then overlaying them on top of each other to create the perfect photo. It also uses sound to transmit data. Currently, the prototype can only reliably send data about 40 meters away, so it's not something that deep sea explorers will be using this weekend. But the technique requires a lot less energy than traditional methods, and it promises to be a breakthrough when they perfect it. Do you remember when NASA's Opportunity rover went offline in 2018? As best as we can tell, poor Oppy was caught up in a Martian dust storm, which clouded its solar panels and made it impossible to generate enough power to function. But perhaps not surprisingly, Opportunity was one of the last NASA rovers that was powered mostly by solar panels. So the new ones, like Curiosity and Perseverance, they have a different energy source. They run using heat. These rovers are powered using a device called a radioisotope thermoelectric generator, or RTG. They work by converting the heat generated by the decay of plutonium-238 into electricity. And to unpack this, we have to take a few steps back. So plutonium-238 is a radioactive isotope, which means it naturally decays to a more stable isotope over time, and that process produces heat. We can take advantage of that heat using a phenomenon known as the Seebeck effect. So if you have two electrical conductors with a temperature difference, electricity will flow between them. Heated electrons always travel from warmer objects to cooler objects. So when you heat one conductor, a charge flows from the hot conductor to the cold one. We've known about this for a long time. In fact, some people out there might have had pacemakers powered by a plutonium generator. NASA loves using thermoelectric generators for their space missions because they have no moving parts that often need to be replaced, so that makes them a really reliable power option. In their RTGs, the radiation heats up one conductor, while the icy void of space, or the frigid Martian landscape, keeps the other one cold. And thermoelectric power isn't just limited to space. A Canadian teen once made a flashlight and a headlamp powered by her own body heat, which is a pretty cool trick, but it relies on the temperature outside being different enough from your body. So if I was wandering around in a dark forest at night, I'd probably just want to bring a backup battery. This next entry on our list of weird ways to make electricity involves light, but it makes use of a technology much older than solar panels. I'm talking about photosynthesis. We're all vaguely familiar with it, right? Plants turning light into food, but that's not a one-step process. Photosynthesis is a series of chemical reactions that convert carbon dioxide and water into oxygen and sugar. These reactions require energy from light to progress. So the type of chemical reactions that occur during photosynthesis are called oxidation reactions, which involve electrons transferring between atoms. And as we've already learned, moving electrons means electricity. Enough electricity to measure, for sure, and maybe enough electricity to harness. Researchers are currently looking into ways to grab some electricity from photosynthesizing plants. And if they succeed, this would be a bonus for the climate, because photosynthesis takes carbon dioxide out of the air instead of adding more into the atmosphere. But while we can see that photosynthesis causes electrons to move around, the challenge is measuring and capturing that current. To figure out the measuring part, researchers from Israel took a succulent leaf and placed an anode and cathode into two different sides, essentially adding the positive and negative ends of a battery. And because succulents contain so much water, the scientists hypothesized that the interior of the leaf would act as the fluid of the battery, carrying charge from one end of the system to another. And they were able to measure how much electricity travels through a single leaf in a day. They found that a succulent leaf generates about 0.28 volts, which is not much. For context, a single car battery generates about 12 volts, but multiple leaves can be strung together to create a circuit, giving the plants a bit of a boost. Other researchers have started looking into cyanobacteria, which is a type of marine bacteria that photosynthesize, in order to figure out how to harness that electricity. Cyanobacteria are the original photosynthesizers. They invented the technique, and their evolution is the reason that life as we know it can exist on Earth today. And it looks like they're still helping us out. By observing these bacteria, researchers from the University of Cambridge found that the start of photosynthesis is a leaky process, meaning like the electrons leak out of the photosynthetic system. The finding is so new that researchers are still working on a solution for grabbing that charge. But the discovery that electrons are released instead of just continuing along the photosynthetic pathway means it's going to be easier to access them and use the power that they create. And because there are a lot of cyanobacteria, it could be a huge source of renewable energy. And it's literally as green as it gets. There's one more weird source of electricity we haven't talked about yet, and it has to do with the air we breathe. Or to be more specific, a part of the air we don't use when we breathe, hydrogen. A soil bacterium called Mycobacterium smegmatis has been discovered to contain an enzyme that can convert the hydrogen gas in the air into electricity. We've been considering hydrogen as an energy source for a while now, but our ideas mostly have to do with burning it to get that sweet, sweet energy. And these bacteria seem to be skipping a step. They initiate a chemical reaction that breaks up hydrogen gas, oxidizing the individual hydrogen atoms. Like we mentioned before in photosynthesis, oxidizing reactions move electrons around, leading to an electrical charge. The enzyme that catalyzes that reaction is called hydrogenase, and we've managed to isolate it. So the next step would be to produce hydrogenase in large enough quantities to be useful. Right now, we can manufacture the stuff in milligrams, but we'd need to bump those numbers up to grams or even kilograms before we can use it commercially. But scientists are hopeful that we can build devices powered by the enzyme in something like a battery. These would be small. Think clocks, LEDs, or even simple computers. But having these devices could take some of the strain off of overloaded grids or provide power in places without other reliable electricity sources. Another air-based electricity source might be able to generate a lot more power, and I'm not talking about the wind. Researchers have found a way to make a synthetic cloud that generates electricity from humidity. Yeah, that stuff that makes you stick to your shirt in the summer might actually have a use. They call it a cloud because water and electricity can move through it in the same way they move through storm clouds, but it's actually made of a thin sheet of engineered material. Apparently, almost any material could work, as long as the synthetic cloud is full of tiny pores. Because those pores are so small, the water molecules bump into the cloud material on their way through. And just like rubbing your feet on the carpet generates static electricity, the water molecules that bump into the cloud end up generating a charge. They make that charge right at the top of the cloud when they first enter. This creates a charge imbalance between the two sides, essentially a battery. Now, they've only tested it with one thin layer of cloud so far, but they're hoping to scale this up to three dimensions, creating even more power. If you're worried about blotting out the sky with monster clouds, don't be. When we say they've made a thin layer of cloud, we're talking about something that's the width of a human hair. Up to 1,000 of those layers stacked on top of each other wouldn't take up that much room. And researchers think that if we could build a synthetic cloud that big, we could deliver power on the order of kilowatts, enough power to feed into the electrical grid. And it would work 24/7, rain or shine, at least in places with humidity. All these ways of generating electricity require more research to make them viable, but the same could be said about solar panels just a few decades ago. It's not just extreme environments like space and the deep sea that'll call for novel ways of powering our devices. Our desire to create enough electricity for everyday use without destroying the planet demands it. And it all starts with the spark of an idea.
Hey, Stefan here, and we just talked about a lot of complicated tech, but that's only scratching the surface. To learn more, you can turn to Brilliant, the interactive online learning platform with thousands of lessons to choose from. They're all about problem solving, not memorizing. So you'll learn about computer science, math, and science through case studies and puzzles that can keep you engaged on the topic. For example, they have a whole course on how technology works that takes you inside the technology you use every day, and it helps you understand how it actually works. You'll learn about computer memory, complete with computational logic and hands-on experiments with transistors. Then you'll get to explore GPS technology and how it manages to pinpoint your location. Not to mention password protection, from what makes a strong password to how websites, accounts, and passwords get compromised. And you'll even learn about stuff that brought you this SciShow video, like video compression. It explains why some online videos buffer and how compression makes streaming possible. So to get started, just head to brilliant.org/SciShow or click the link in the description down below. And that link will also give you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription, and you'll get your first 30 days for free. Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video.